Senator Tom Cotton of Arkansas is joining me today to discuss the coronavirus, China, President Trump's impeachment trial, and much more. Senator Cotton, thanks so much for joining me today.
Sure, Samantha. Thanks for having me on with you.
Now, the World Health Organization said Tuesday that they are no longer pursuing an investigation into whether COVID-19 leaked from a Wuhan lab. Is the lab leak theory dead then, you know, with these latest findings?
I guess that settles it, Samantha. We should just put it all behind us. The World Health Organization, which has proven itself to be such an impartial arbiter over the last year of China's role in spreading this plague around the world, has spoken, and therefore no one else can ever speak about it again. But obviously, that's not the case. The WHO has been a Chinese communist stooge from the very beginning, going back to December of 2019. What needs to happen is an independent team of Western scientists, to include American scientists, need to have access to everything that happened in Wuhan in the fall of 2019, to include access to the Wuhan Institute of Virology. Now, as I've said all along, there's not direct evidence that this virus came from one of those labs, but all the circumstantial evidence points to those labs as the source, most likely as a kind of accidental breach. We know that China's had a long history of sloppy safety practices in their laboratories. We also know that Department of State officials visited this lab in particular in 2018, and they were worried about the safety practices they saw there. Other circumstantial evidence shows the Chinese Communist Party engaged in a cover-up from the very beginning. You know, they pointed to this so-called wet market, a kind of open-air food market selling various kinds of animals that didn't even sell the kind of bat that it's believed that this virus came from. So all the evidence, albeit circumstantial, points towards those laboratories. I don't really care what the WHO says. There needs to be an independent assessment of what happened there. We may never have that because the Chinese Communist Party is so deceitful about such matters. But until they come clean, they do not deserve any benefit of the doubt.
The Trump administration, on its final day in office, labeled this Chinese Communist Party was committing genocide against the Uyghur Muslims. The current Secretary of State agreed with that statement. What happens now? You know, how does that affect the United States' relationship with China?
Well, I certainly hope that all of the big multinational companies that are making billions of dollars in China, to include money off of slave labor in Northwest China, will reconsider their relationship with China to do business with a genocidal nation, a nation that we now know, thanks to whistleblowers who have escaped some of those concentration camps, that engages in mass torture and mass rape of women, is not a country in which they ought to be doing business. This is part of a broader need to reassess our fundamental relationship with China. We need to decouple our economy. We need to bring supply chains and production out of China back to the United States to the greatest degree possible, at least back to allied countries. And we need to reduce the influence that the new China lobby has over policy in this country. Now, that's going to be hard to do because there's so many companies that are deeply embedded in China, universities and think tanks that take Chinese money, industries like Hollywood that are dependent on access to the Chinese market. But to do business with a genocidal nation that engages in mass rape as a system of ethnic suppression, I think is beyond the pale for most Americans.
Just to shift topics a little bit, President Donald Trump's second impeachment trial is starting Tuesday. What do you think of, you know, the trial itself? And, you know, we found out about 2 weeks ago that there aren't enough votes to effectively convict President Trump. With that in mind, why are Senate Democrats doing this?
Well, I think even though Donald Trump moved down to the White House 3 weeks ago, he's still living rent-free in the Democrats' heads. They're just obsessed with Donald Trump. It's the one thing that unifies their party, and they can't seem to let him go. As you said, 2 weeks ago, 45 senators voted to move to a motion to dismiss on the grounds that it's beyond the constitutional authority of the Senate to have impeachment proceedings to convict and remove from office a man who left office 3 weeks ago. It just is illogical. I don't think it makes sense to many Americans. That's why I said the day the House passed its rushed article of impeachment, it was beyond their constitutional authority. It wouldn't surprise me if we have more than 45 votes this week to dismiss it on those constitutional grounds, because some of those people who voted 2 weeks ago voted simply because they wanted to hear the arguments before they made a final decision on that. But I think for most Americans, they look at what's happening in the Senate this week, and they wonder why the Democratic Senate wants to obsess about Donald Trump 2 weeks, 3 weeks after he left office, when we should be doing things like focusing on the migrant crisis that Joe Biden's executive orders has unleashed on our southern border, or trying to get vaccines distributed more efficiently to our states so more people can be vaccinated faster and we can move beyond the pandemic, not having an impeachment trial for a man who left office 3 weeks ago.
Now, you just touched upon, some executive orders by President Biden in regard to immigration. I know you put out a statement against what he has been doing. Can you talk a little bit about what you are doing personally to sort of address your concerns regarding these immigration executive orders?
You know, when the New York Times and the Washington Post, not exactly stalwarts of immigration restriction, both write over this past weekend that there is a brand new crisis on our border with migrants surging to our country because of Joe Biden's campaign promises and executive orders, you know that there's really a crisis. It's because Joe Biden, throughout the campaign, said he was going to rescind all of Donald Trump's border control policies and give free health care to illegal aliens that we now have thousands and thousands of migrants showing up at our southern border, in many cases being released into the country in the middle of a pandemic when they haven't even been tested, they haven't been vaccinated, yet we require people who fly into this country legally to have a negative test. We may even start requiring Americans to fly domestically to have a test. I think that's an outrageous policy. It goes to show that Joe Biden is once again putting Americans last and putting foreigners first. It is time to reverse these insane immigration policies that are encouraging this migrant surge at our border and threatening our workers and threatening our public health and safety.
The impeachment trial has a lot to do with the future of the Republican Party and whether or not, you know, President Trump might run again in the future. With that in mind, you know, do you agree with the people who say that the Republican Party should be the party of the working man? And if so, what policies should the party be pursuing?
Well, I want the Republican Party to be the party of all Americans, and I want it to welcome as many Americans as we can to our party. I think we have a strong and growing majority coalition on the horizon. We have won over the last 4 years many more working class blue collar voters across the country as they recognize that the Democratic Party is increasingly the party of urban coastal elites who want to raise their taxes and defund their police and open their borders, who have sold them out for decades by sending their factories to China or bringing in migrant workers to take their jobs here while imposing the most ridiculous fads and fashions on their cultural views. So the Republican Party is speaking to those voters. Now, we also saw in the last election that we lost some races because we had lost suburban voters, and we have to win those voters back as well. Now, I think that the Biden administration and the insanity coming out of the Congress when the first priorities of the Democratic House are both impeaching a president who's leaving office and changing their rules so they don't reflect gendered pronouns are going to help the Republican Party win back a lot of those voters next year. But we need to continue to appeal to the broad working class of Americans who simply want a chance to make a decent living in jobs of their choice, who don't want to be lectured to, who don't want to be threatened either by crime and disorder at home or by a menacing China or a threatening Iran or terrorist abroad. That's the party that's going to win a broad majority coalition in the future.
Something else that, you know, Democrats were pushing in the early days and are continuing to push is this race for the minimum wage. $15, I believe it was by 2025. What do you think of this? And, you know, why not push for a higher minimum wage?
Well, at some point, yeah, I mean, you can just keep raising the minimum wage if you don't believe that there's a limited amount of money or that it's not going to cost jobs. Now, I'm open to raising the minimum wage. It hasn't been raised at the federal level in over a decade. In Arkansas, we already have an $11 an hour minimum wage. If we do that, though, I think we need to take a few other steps. One, we need to make sure that we index it to inflation so workers can have steady pay raises each year and businesses don't have to deal with the situation where they have their minimum wage doubled in some cases after inaction for a decade. So like any other cost of doing business, the minimum wage would be going up by 1, 2, 3% a year. That's the first step we should take if we're going to raise the minimum wage in Washington. The second step is to pair it with mandatory E-Verify. Right now, a lot of companies across America use E-Verify so they don't employ illegal aliens, but they're not required to. All companies, large and small, should be required to use E-Verify. So we make sure that if we raise the minimum wage, those increased wages are going to American workers, not foreign workers. So those are a couple steps we need to take if we are going to consider raising the minimum wage in Washington.
Some of the concerns with raising the minimum wage is obviously, you know, it would disproportionately affect small businesses versus these, you know, huge multinational companies that can effectively afford to pay these workers a higher wage. Do you think there should be, you know, more flexibility in terms of minimum wages for these huge companies versus these smaller businesses?
Well, you know, some of these large companies that are lobbying and advertising on behalf of a higher minimum wage have already started paying that wage internally. So it's an action where they're trying to use the power of government to disadvantage some of their competitors. Another consideration we could have with the minimum wage debate is maybe raising the threshold for which the federal minimum wage applies. Right now, it's very, very low. But if you raise the number of employees for a company that reaches federal minimum wage, that would exempt a lot of very small businesses, you know, businesses with 5 or 10 people. Now, they'd still have the state minimum wage. And like I said, in some states like Arkansas, we have an $11 minimum wage, or Florida just voted to phase in a $15 minimum wage over a number of years, so it wouldn't be so disruptive. So that's another thing we could do to make sure that while that we're not disrupting very small businesses for whom a doubling, an immediate doubling of the minimum wage would be very disruptive to their business and probably also cost jobs for those people who are making at or near the minimum wage.
Well, Senator Tom Cotton, I so appreciate you taking the time to speak with me. I know you have a busy schedule ahead of you, so I so appreciate you coming on and hope you'll join me again soon.
Yeah, thank you very much, Samantha.